let's go ahead. So, all right. So this is kind of the title slide. So this time sensitive networking, or TSN, and with a focus on the integrated cut-through switching, time synchronization, and preemption. So maybe some of you might be more familiar with the time-aware shaper as a typical central focus, but I'll touch upon it, but I'll focus on actually on cut-through, time synchronization, and preemption. So the flow I'm going to go through is I'll give like a sneak peek of the actual demo of actually something running on silicon to kind of get the motivation going there in the beginning. Then a little bit of a refresher on the features that we'll be demoing, or basically showing screenshots of the demo. So I took the weaseled my way out, and instead of running the demos live, I took screenshots just to make sure I kind of stay within the time bounds here. So first we'll show configuring the AM64, 6442 EVM and starter kit boards for cut-through switching with preemption. Then there'll be the kind of the fundamental piece of time-sensitive networking is the time part of it. So I'll demo the PTP or the 802.1AS 2011 version. I mean, the hardware is capable of the 2020 version, but the Linux software stack so far is not. And then kind of round it up with a demonstration of the cut-through switching for express traffic with a background traffic. And all of this is basically kind of done from the Linux command line. So I'm not demonstrating a real-time application, but just using typical networking tools that are available in the standard file system we have. And then we'll hopefully have time for some questions and answers at the end. And I think we'll also have a couple pauses so please go ahead and type in some questions, and I'll answer those in the when kind of Ron holds me. Okay, so this is the sneak peek of what the actual demo is, or what I have running here on my desk. So it's two starter kits, two GPE VMs, and then a local area network just for connectivity purposes to a Ubuntu machine that I use for the development. But all of the traffic generation and so on is in the local area network of the EVM to the SK. So for kind of console type purposes. Okay, and really the heart of it is the AM64 device that has an integrated TSN capable Ethernet switch, two ports out, one port in. That's where that sometimes called three ports, but it's two external ports. Okay, yeah, and I put this picture in that it doesn't look as pretty. Sorry for the, just wanted to show it's somewhat real there with the, I should have taken some shorter cables to make it prettier, but yeah. Okay, so what do we have on, what do we support today on the AM64 family of devices? Right, TSN is an umbrella term, Ethernet layer 2 features for real-time performance. So what TSN exactly means is up to the reader. I mean, is it which of the features one supports is up to the interpretation. So, and we have the support available on several DARA devices that are shipping today, and also some Jacinto devices. So higher end parts. Okay. The key features that I'll be showing and that we already have support for is really in the Linux IP Route 2 package and Linux PTP. But in addition to that, we support cut-through switching, which is not standardized by IEEE yet. there is some activity around it, but it's not really, it's not standardized, but yes, we do support it. And I'll show a little more detail on how we have that supported. And that will be part of the demo. Okay, for the timing over packet, I'll show it running in this line topology. I won't go into the kind of the nuances of because it'll be its own presentation. We actually have a generic PTP presentation also available. But it's Linux PTP based, so basically the PTP 4L is the application. Then also preemption, and for both preemption and time over shaper, the integration we have on AM64 is based on the standard Linux building blocks of ETH tool and TC command and the QDisk, TC QDisk commands. So ETH tool to set how many hardware queues and TC command to tell what traffic goes into which queue. And then for time over shaper, setting up the schedule. All right, and then I have a typical reminder that are in the questions, right? That the TSN or quality of service in general, what it guarantees is that there won't be interference from lower priority traffic. It by itself doesn't guarantee you'll meet real time. It's just that it's a tool to enforce some part of the traffic to not interfere with the what's typically called higher priority or real time traffic. So really, it's enforcing that there isn't something interfering. Do you actually manage to send stuff in time? Is up to the application. The TSN just gives you the window time slot or the opportunity to meet timing. Okay, so then quick refresher, one sliders on the key features. So I won't go into the details to kind of keep up with the time, but it'll be in the material. So time aware shaper or QBV as the pre-approval name of it went in IEEE, which is the approved specs is called ESD or enhancements to scheduled traffic. A lot of acronyms there, but really it's basically TDM time slots over Ethernet wire. I put some pictures on the right to kind of show it. So there's a list of gates are open that get cycled through, and thus you can enforce that if I'm putting stuff in this queue, they're in within every millisecond, for example. There will be a window of, let's say, 125 microseconds to get my motion control traffic through. That will be a one example usage of the scheme. Okay, so then the rest is kind of gets semi the optional, meaning the exact details of what is supported. We have 8 hardware queues and a 128 entry list are maybe the key metrics that are supported today. The 128 list gets split into two if you use the admin operational, meaning you have a different schedule that you're preparing, and then you swap to use it, then it gets to 64. But maybe the key to one more note there is like the whole point with this is everybody needs to be time synchronized in order for this scheme to work across the local area network. So getting the PTP running is a kind of a prerequisite for using time over shaper. Okay, preemption is in hardware perhaps more complicated, but I guess from the usage perspective, much simpler because there's really just two priorities, either you're express or you're not. Express means I cannot be preempted, and the rest can be preempted. So it's a very simple way of creating one express or one real-time class, and everybody else gets worse treatment. we support that for each of the So you can have up to the all 8 hardware queues. Each of them can be either express or preemptable. Most commonly, you'd only have a couple express traffic queues. Otherwise, the value of the express kind of goes away. And then the two nuances is PTP is less critical here because the preemption itself doesn't need synchronization across the LAN local area network. This is of course not standardized, but in our implementation and in our view in general, cut-through switching only makes sense for express traffic. So background traffic is background traffic configured as preemptible will fall back to store and forward. Yeah. Okay. Then this is just the part of how the access to those hardware queues is available from Linux is the TC command, part of that IP route 2 package, and traffic classes in the queuing discipline. So you have these 16 socket priorities or SKP priorities. Those get mapped to the hardware queues, and the optionally offloaded to hardware. That's what we have supported. So you can use the standard Linux TC QDisk commands to put traffic into the local area network at a given TSN feature. Yeah. So and then I put like a generic link here to because it's not a kind of the value of our implementation. I think here is it's not a proprietary to TI. It's the interface is the same as whether you had hardware offload or not for the features, and it's the same interface regardless. It's standard Linux interface. Okay, jumping to the cut-through switching. So this is what I'll be demoing, and I put some performance numbers there too. Right, the normal Ethernet is you receive a packet, the entire packet has to be received, then the CRC is calculated, forwarding decision is made, and it's sent out. So at a gigabit rate, that means a 1,500 or 1,500 byte frame, it will take about 12 microseconds, basically 1,500 times 8 nanoseconds per byte or 1 nanosecond per bit to buffer. So that's the store part. So the point with cut-through is what if I, because the destination MAC address is at the beginning of the frame. So what if I don't store, when I start forwarding even before I get the CRC at the end? So that's what we support. Now, what we do is we don't want to forward just based on the MAC address. So we support the full lookup up to IPv6 QoS bits or that means we have to receive 80 bytes of the frame before we make the forwarding decision. That's why the cut-through switching is that's the bulk of the why the cut-through switching is over. It's not less than a microsecond. It's a little bit over. I put the math a little bit down there, but anyway, that's a quick intro to the cut-through. Okay, maybe pause there. Any questions? Open and rush to it too quickly.
We had one question, Pekka, but I was able to answer it. I just wanted to clarify that the capabilities that we're talking about with TSN today, we're using the CPSW hardware switch. So some of you may be aware of the PRU or the ICSSG, which we've added to also be able to do TSN capabilities. And that's something else that we have the capability of, but today we're focusing on the CPSW.
Yep.
And that's the only question we had so far. So I'd keep rolling, and you guys and gals, keep the questions coming. We'd be glad to answer your questions.
Yep. Okay. So now I'm kind of moving on to the actual demo version. So what I was going to do here is I'll focus on the setting up the cut-through switch with preemption with 4 boards. I'll have the initial description of what I'm doing, and then I'll have the actual commands to get there afterwards. So kind of the overview followed by the ugly details, which are actually not that ugly. So yeah, okay. So I physically set up the EVMs in this line topology. I happen to put the two GP EVMs, general purpose EVMs, which are the little bit larger boards with more interfaces exposed. I put them as the two first ones and then two starter kit boards after. The order doesn't really matter and the commands are the same. But anyway, this is what I was using in the screenshots that I'll use. Yeah, and the one note here is, I mean, the idea is that if you want to replicate this, so you should be able to do this based on the material. So you have to use the console boards, so the serial ports here, because we are taking down the Ethernet to move from a Mac to a switched case. So you have to use the consoles. You can't use an SSH or Telnet connection because the Ethernet goes down for a short couple seconds there. And so set up the serial ports, which sometimes is the most, I don't know, time-consuming part of doing this. So I put a link here to a pretty good quick start guide that that a colleague of mine and the team did recently. So that's a good starting point. It's a good starting point for both boards, but it's specifically done for the starter kit. Connect four serial ports for USB cables, starting with the board that's I'm running the DHCP server, so I'm using getting IP addresses from my Linux desktop machine here, which is running a DHCP server. So that's why I start from that side. I mean, you could also run give static IP addresses, and then the order doesn't matter, but this is maybe simpler. All right, so starting from the one closest to the Linux machine, boot the board up. By default, with the SDK we have, they come in a, what we call dual Mac or two Ethernet ports mode, So then run those few commands that I'll show to go instead to use a switch. So do it one by one from the in order for the DHCP to be able to get the IP address. That's really the fundamental reason of doing it one by one. Okay. Yes. And now we get to hopefully this doesn't look too ugly here because it's still so I split it, so the on each of those boards, this is the commands that I'm running, or the script that I'm running. It'll be on two slides, but I just wanted to kind of show it, and you'll be able to cut and paste it from here if you want to try it. So yeah, in order to change the configuration, you need to take the Ethernet ports down, and then in order to enable preemption, need to. In this case, I'm configuring it for just two queues. I'm not exposing all the eight queues. I really have just two queues. I have express traffic and I have preemptible traffic. So those each two commands are like, okay, let's go to two queues. And now instead of the default round robin, I want preemption. So that's the that's these commands over here. So turn off preemption, turn off round robin, add preemption, and then this IET MAC verify on. There is in preemption, there is an optional feature. One step back. In preemption, there is a negotiation with LLDP messages to ask that you plug in a cable, LLDP will ask, do you support the preemption, and there'll be a response sequence and et cetera. The current Linux or open source LLDP does not support this. So that's just as a note. From the standards perspective, that's actually mandatory. That's where we are currently with the open source. But then there is a lower level Ethernet, like a kind of a preamble, special preamble exchange sequence, which is called MAC verify. There's a special preamble that's sent, and then the peer is supposed to send a response to that, and they agree on, yes, I can support preemption, and I support these fragment sizes. So that's, we support that. It's an optional feature. We have it supported, and it's supported in Linux too. So I turned it on. There's really no downside to in my opinion, to not turning it on. So, but yeah, but it's not mandatory. If you leave it off, the preemption will still work. It'll just assume the other side does support it. Okay, then there's this magical command line that we have a hard Ethernet switch. That's this this line here, the dev leveling feature. Okay, then what I have next is the what queues support cut through. So I'm using the basically I picked by default VLAN priority is 0. I decided to use VLAN priority 3 as the cut through express traffic. So I'm identifying the TSN stream with the VLAN priority. So I set up 8 is just the bitmap for the PC the queue the VLAN 3. Yep. Okay. I said the cut through. So this interface is, as you can see, it's not yet on the could change down the road these commands, but essentially you set the which queues are cut through express traffic, and then this part is all kind of a clean standard Linux setting up a switch. So I tell the let's create a host port, which I call BR0. Basic learning switch setup. Now I have this port BR0, and I had the two physical ports that were down in the previous slide. So I turned those up. Need to wait a little bit, 1 second, because there's going to be a link negotiation. Once Ethernet ports goes up, it'll negotiate. And at this point, it'll also fire off that preemption, the verify sequence. And now that the Ethernet level, the link's up, the MAC level is up. But then I want to connect those two physical Ethernet ports to this BR0 port. Now I have a relationship between the physical ports to the host port or the BR0 port. Tell it that start bridging between those ports and bring up the host port. I had previously told, it was on the previous slide, that I have for that bridging, I have that dev link, I have that hardware offload. Then the bridge command here is to make sure that untagged traffic shows up because the bridge comes up in a VLAN aware mode. By convention, VLAN ID 1 is used for untagged traffic. So I think this is to I get those packets come in. Then it's just the bridge control is just you could drop that command. It's just to see that the switch is there, and then I want to get an IP address. So all that script runs through. So this sequence, these commands. So basically, the first slide essentially goes for the cut through, and first slide commands go for the setting up the preemption and cut through, and the second creates a switch. So if you just want to set up a switch, it's the second slide worth of commands. Okay.
Hey, Pekka, we got a couple of questions about the scripts and setups. So let's run through those. The first one, which I tried to address in the Q&A, but I wanted to see if you wanted to refer to it, is since we are using CPSW, you know, would all of this work on an AM335X? And I listed the things that we're talking about today, like preemption, cut through, and TAS that are not supported on 335X. While it has some TSN basic capabilities, it wouldn't be able to do those things. Did I get that right?
Yeah, that's correct. And maybe I can add to that. This preemption, this won't work on a 333, or these parts are not relevant because the feature is not there. Perhaps the issue is with the current SDK, there isn't a hardware driver for the switch that's compatible with these commands. I mean, conceptually we could have it, but with the 335, you still have to do the device tree level decide whether you want it to be a switch or not. The runtime is not in the current SDK.
Okay, thank you for that. And then we got one other question about the actual setup of the demo. And the question was, why would we need to wait 1 second after link up in your scripts?
So I should have put a screenshot here, which I didn't. I'll come back to, I'll show that. I think one of the screenshots I have coming up later shows the sequence. What happens, it's kind of the same that when I do this command, IP link set device Ethernet 0 up, that's the same as unplugging the cable from the RJ45 cable and putting it back in. Then the kind of that hardware link level negotiation kicks up. So it's out of negotiating what's going to be the speed and et cetera. So that's where the sleep one comes in. If I don't do that, the link is not actually yet up when the next command is run and the script will fail. It's probably less than 1 second would work. It's just difficult to use the one second.
Okay, Pekka, that catches us up with the questions we have so far, so feel free to keep going.
All right, yes. So now, got the time. Yep, so I'll jump into now the PTP or the 802.1 AS 2011 or GPTP. Which is supported in the current SDK with the previously done switching setup. So I have that switching setup done, and what I want to do, I've broken down a couple slides, is within this local area network of these four AN64s, which in describing these, I one of them is going to be the grandmaster, and the others are going to be the others, or as the exact terminology in the PTP world is they're called slaves. But if I call them other, that's other or slave is equivalent from the functional perspective. Yep. Okay. So as a summary, this all works, and the result is which I'll show is it converges to a single digit nanosecond accuracy. This is the prep work, which is not required by the PDP, but it's just to make it easier to that the Linux clock is actually using that PDP clock. So in some cases, that might not be what the application wants. You might have a LAN clock and the Linux clock, two separate clocks. But here with these commands, yeah. So what I did, I mean, the EVMs come up. Nobody's told them what was the day, and this is telling me that this part of the screenshot I ran it almost a month ago. So that's why I had the May there. So I said on the one that I decided to be the grandmaster, I do it. The following commands I do first. So I set the date. And of course, on the other ones, the date is whatever happened to be on the SD card. And then I run this THC to sys to take the PDP clock to system clock. And that's where the magic is, the second R. Second R is there. That on the grandmaster, I allow the local Linux clock to be the master. And then this transport specific flag is you can look it in the Linux PDP documentation, but that's the 802.1 one AS domain. Okay, so I run those commands, and there's three of them. But yeah, so yeah, to start so that okay, what if I get the clock from the PDP, use that for the system clock. That's the command to do that. Yeah, and then all those commands are non-TI specific. Those are generic. So all generic Linux PDP documentation will apply. So okay, and essentially because these are all the same kind of boards, the first one is going to be the grandmaster, at least in the start. So the key is the one I had the second R here to say that I can source the clock. Run this command on it first. And okay, I'll just looks a little bit cryptic, but of course you could have this. But it's pretty clear to just walk through it. Okay, use peer-to-peer clocking, which and two means layer two, as opposed to IP level packets for timing. H is hardware timestamp, switch interface, and now because I'm switch, I tell the both physical interfaces out. The BR0 port that I created, I don't want to use that. I want to use the ones that are the timestamps from the where hardware timestamps are supported, the external ports. Then this is the one tweak compared to the standard SD card that I needed to get this file. This is specific to the AS 2011, so gtp.config file. I put a link here where you can get it, and I just the only tweak I did to it is I added the datasheet values for the PHY chip we're using. Otherwise, this gptp config file is downloaded from GitHub. You don't have to do this command, but this is just to make it 2011 compliant. It's got a few options in there. Okay. And the rest is kind of the PDP zero, because we have multiple counters on the chip. This is just to use the zero. Okay. So then run this on the first board, the one you wanted to be grandmaster, then run it on the other ones, and maybe you can, if you wanted to type date, and you'll see, okay, hey, the other one's got the times. There's more great documentation on this at this link. So now I'll show what it kind of looked like. On the grandmaster, it's like, yeah, out of the box, it comes out in April, and then I was okay. Let's set the date, and started as the grandmaster, and then on the other boards, this is what will look like. It'll the PDP 4L will come up, and it'll fairly quickly decide that this guy who was up there first. Is going to be the best master. And then you see the convergence goes fairly quickly. It'll get stuck to this level of about up to 10 the error and the fixed delay. So if you didn't put the PHY chip values correctly, this will be a larger number. But because the PHY delay is fixed in that gptp config file, you'll just see a different number here. But okay, so this was PDP. And a pause there. Any questions?
Yeah, Pekka, we got a couple of more questions on the other setup, not necessarily PTP, or I haven't seen any on PTP. So I missed this one earlier. I apologize about that. The AM64X GPEVM that you're using, you're showing in a switch configuration. We wanted to confirm that you're able to use two CPSW ports from that board, There seemed to be some understanding that two of them were peer you and only one was CPSW.
No, okay, yeah, okay, good point. I probably should have clarified that, and that should be in one of our user guides. But yes, so there is a, on the GPE EVM, there's three ports. There's one standalone RJ45 and two stacked. By default, the Linux file system device tree and Pinmux, it comes up with the CPSW having two ports. The top one, on the stacked connector, the top one, and then the standalone one. What we have on the chip level Pinmux is actually that one RGMII interface is choosable inside the chip to be either ICSSG or CPSW. So the second Ethernet port it's a Pinmux inside the chip to choose, is it ICSS or CPSW. In the Linux SDKs, we have it as a CPSW by default.
And that's just a Pinmux change, so just a simple device tree change, and you can switch that back over to the PRU
port. Correct, yes, exactly, yes.
Okay, and then on the setup scripts, once again, a clarification that you have the waiting 1 second, and we're doing those things. But the question was, so do you have to have the ports all up and plugged in when you run these scripts?
No, you don't. I'm just running it without. That's a good point. Right. This script works with the standard file system SD card image, which has a certain setup and certain services are started so that's why I need to take them down first. So you could of course have it by default come up as a switch.
You could also probably write some scripts to detect when a status changes and run certain commands to handle things that way as well, I'm sure.
Correct. Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Great. All right, that catches us up on questions. Keep them coming, audience. We sure appreciate them. But Pekka, keep rolling through. You've got about 18 minutes left.
All right, thanks. Yes. All right, so now we get to the QoS setup. So I'll show first, or like the express cut through traffic. So, okay, so I'll first show like nothing DSN as a reference point, what happens, and then introduce the preemption. Okay, so my goal is, is the red is my real-time symbolic application, 10 megabits of 200 byte packets, real-time traffic. That's my representative real-time application. It's the red arrow, so it goes from the leftmost one to the rightmost one, and for that I'm using just a simple iperf 3 UDP command as written there. That's the symbolizes the real-time traffic. And to create the burst of background traffic, basically I'm just using a TCP throughput test, which is, in this case, I'm using netperf, again, these are part of our default file system, including the server for netperf is already listening. So I just need to run it. So, of course, this is where you would replace with instead of iperf, your real-time application is probably something other than iperf. But this is just representative of that. And this is just showing the IP addresses just to, because it'll maybe be easier to see the printouts. Okay, so what happens? This is what it looks like. I took two of the screens of the two of the machines. So this. The real-time traffic is okay. The command I showed, it basically runs forever, and this is what I see is okay. I get the 10 megabits going, and then for this moment of time where the netperf throughput test runs, I see this drop. And I think netperf runs by default 10 seconds. So is it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10? Yeah, it's the same. It's roughly the same length. So, okay, that burst of background traffic if I kind of go back here, so the leftmost one was trying to be talk to the rightmost one in real time. So real time UDP traffic wanted to go through. It goes through these switches, but the moment the throughput test starts basically dumping as much TCP traffic as it can, it will congest at this port. So the traffic, the real-time traffic coming from here will start competing with the throughput test at that port, and the result is packet drops, lower throughput. Okay, so how do I get the preemption and cut through traffic to showcase real time? Okay, the way to identify TSN streams is there are several ways to do that. I'm using VLAN priority all the way through this. This is perhaps the simplest conceptually, that that all traffic at a given VLAN priority is my real time traffic. So I'm creating a VLAN. So everything is the same up to this point. I didn't take anything down. But in addition to that VR0 port, I'll create a VLAN with the arbitrary VLAN tag of 100 on all of these four boards, and with the goal of putting the real-time traffic on a VLAN priority 3 and the throughput traffic on priority 0, or the default priority. The development is not part of the development machine is not part of the VLAN. Sorry. Okay, so yeah, like I said, using TCP, using VLAN priority as the TSN stream identifier. Now, by default, iperf and netperf, they use socket priority or SKP priority 0. So I just need to find a way to map this iperf to VLAN priority 3, which in the previous scripts was made express and cut through. And the middle two, the netperf traffic, I wanted that to be on BGP, on the VLAN priority 0. All right, so how do I get there? On the middle two, I just create the VLAN. The way to create VLAN with IP link commands is this, you see br0.100. The .100, that's just a convention, that probably should follow. But yeah, that the VLAN, there's an extra MAC port in the virtual LAN now, that's at the and then I give it a static IP addresses, because I'm working at the IP level, so I need to iperf and netperf work at the IP level. I'm not sending raw Ethernet packets on the VLAN, so I need to give in this case I'm giving static IP addresses. I could of course have a DHCP server that's inside the VLAN, but this maybe got a little too complicated. So I just give it static IP addresses where the last number is the same as the DHCP gave me for simplification. Yep, so this is the command to give the IP address. And on the endpoint ones, I marked it here in red, I'm forcing all default traffic to use the VLAN TCP 3. So this egress QoS map 0 to 3 is if I were to recompile, I don't know, iperf, and instead in the escape priority say 3, then I would probably, it would be more logical to say eager QoS map 3 to 3, but anyway, that's up to the kind of the application. So anyway, so all traffic now on the endpoint ones is going to look like real time, and all traffic on the middle ones is going to be default. And this is a reminder there that this part is really just for demonstration purposes. The socket priority is probably what you use, and map accordingly. Yep. Okay, so this is what the network use would look like, and the commands are basically the same commands. Now, the only difference is the real-time traffic now everything's on in the VLAN, and the real-time traffic is getting the cut-through treatment. Okay, so now I will. The QoS, here you see this one is the board where I set the default traffic to use the VLAN priority 3. And I'm running now. So showing the window for the TCP test looks the same. So I didn't copy it over, now the 10 second disturbance doesn't really show up. Now that did it, the 99.99 or something. But I think that's just an artifact of the test tool. So this is now showing that you run the same sequence, run the background traffic, and there's no disturbance. Okay, this doesn't yet really show the latency part of it, right? This is, you could still argue that you get the same performance with the strict priority. So then there's these couple commands here that you will see the statistics counters for the what's going on, which is the ETH tool commands for each of the Ethernet ports. You can go look at whichever you want to see what's going on with preemption. So ETH tool, either you get all the counters or if you just grep for the counters with IET, you'll see the number of fragments and so on. And if you run this command at the, for example, at the same time you just have the real-time traffic going, the counters are not incrementing. There's no fragments. Then you run the TCP test. Okay, the fragments, pretty much everything gets fragmented with the TCPs using maximum size packets. So the counters grow quite quickly. And then you see the same for the cut-through counters. Here, there's a little bit of an unfortunate complication because the statistics counter is kind of getting overflown, so overused. So what we're doing is I'm using the collision. We're using the hardware's collecting statistics, but when cut through is on, we are reusing these collision frames counters to document the cut through features. Again, this is like a cut-through is not standardized, so and then the statistics is not standardized, so this is what we chose because those collision frames are kind of not relevant in a gigabit network. So you'll see the cut-through counters and how many packets were cut through, how many were stored and forwarded. So by using these two statistics commands, you'll see the cut-through happening. Yeah, okay, and then addressing kind of the last part so why in this webinar and this demo I didn't show the time over shaper, because really the biggest I could do a similar endpoint only demo. We have in some of the documentation we have examples of how to do this, and I put some links in here, but because in a local area network with multiple switches, the configuration stack of those time over shapers and time slots becomes pretty critical. So then manually configuring those time slots and delays is quite tedious and probably not that productive. So you can get an endpoint demo, but for a switch you will need a configuration stack, which, to be transparent, we don't provide, but we would expect that because we're using standard Linux interfaces, the porting effort. There's no TI-specific porting effort to support that on our device. And then to kind of see the arrival TDM nature of the packets. Really, the only useful tool is essentially a TCP dump to a PCAP file, or if you put some filters there, even to the screen, you can see the arrival times and look at it with Wireshark. But again, because we are we're at a gigabit level, microseconds. The LAN is working at microseconds, but the packet collection with TCP dump is going to be more in the tens of microseconds level. So you have to be considerate of those when and analyzing the results. The inaccuracy is going to be in the timestamping. One way to get rid of that is to slow down the interface. So with each tool, you can just configure it to 100 megabit or 10 megabit. And then you do see quite easily the timing characteristics, but that's of course a little bit academic because you probably want to run the network at a gigabit. Okay. And then of course for the preemption and cut through, I acknowledge I didn't really show the achieved latency. That would really need a application GPIO pin toggle and a logic analyzer type setup. Hopefully, let's see it. Yes. So I think we're basically at the end. Hopefully that was useful, and that should be something that you would be interested in taking a look at. So this is a summary where we covered is the TSN features we support on AM64 family of devices, and then some demo of setting this line topology of four devices. Getting the 802.1AS running, and then demonstrating some express and background traffic. Okay. Yeah, I think that's. I can maybe leave this one up here. There's a previous webinar on Wi-Fi and a little bit more on the setting up the switch and bridging functions. And here's some other links to the actual product page and the EVM pages. So any further questions?
Just had a question come in. Becca, let me just let me read it, see if you can, if it makes more to you. You know a lot more about this stuff than I do. Is the real-time VLAN prioritized packet get through the cut-through setting all the time, even if the packet is for local IP? No packet inspection possible. Is it a trade-off of latency?
Okay, let me see. Yeah, okay. The VLAN setup is on the the cut through only happens for packets that got out of the got transmitted out to a physical wire, from the BR0 port, even if it's the BR0100 VLAN port, regardless. The application gives the entire packet in software to hardware, so that part is kind of mandatory to be stored and forward. So then if you're sending the self on the VLAN, there is really no cut through because always at the destinations it's a store and forward, meaning the application is not notified when the beginning of the Ethernet frame showed up. It is notified when the entire frame has been received and CRC has been validated, then the packet is given to software. I don't know if that answers the question.
Okay, we'll see. I think that was the intent of the question. Oh, yep, got confirmation that, yep, that made sense. So thank you for that. Got another question. When will the AM6442 be RTM'd? And we are currently targeting the end of next year for RTM. That's release to manufacturing. So that's when you could build a device and go to production. And the 6442 is fully released. It's available on ti.com today. You can purchase the EVMs that Pekka has up on the screen here. The GP EVM and the starter kit are both available. You can play around with both of those, start your development, all the collateral that you should need to build a board yourself and start building your application to solve your problems should all be available to you. So you can start that process today. And as Pekka mentioned, here are some resources for you. We will update the E2E post that announced the webinar with all the relevant information, including the PDF of this presentation, which will of course give you the links to these different resources. So you can check that if you would like. And we want to thank you. We are at time. We want to respect your time. Know that you have lots of other stuff to go do to build new products with AM6442. So we want to get you over to that. We just want to express our appreciation. Thank you, Pekka, for presenting. Thank you, audience, for choosing to join us today. I hope that was very useful to you. If not, hit us up on the E2E post. Let us know what you'd like to see different. Both Pekka and I are actively involved with our customers on E2E and would love to hear your feedback or ideas on what you'd like to see done differently. So thank you very much, and we will end here, and we hope the rest of your day, whatever is left, is great, and that you'll join us for our next webinar. We're doing these about once a month, and you can look at E2E for our announcements. Thank you so much once again. Have a great day.